Capital budgeting is trying to decide whether or not to spend big sums of money on big projects. At the heart of that is cash flow estimation and risk analysis. We're going to look at incremental cash flows, not net income. We're going to look at possible increases in net operating working capital. For example, if we open a retail store, we're not only going to have to build the store, we're going to have to stick some cash into the registers. We're not going to deduct interest expense when we do these cash flow estimations because the interest expense is already accounted for in our weighted average cost of capital, which will be our discount rate. We're going to ignore sunk costs. Money that's been spent can't be unspent, but we will look for opportunity costs. For example, if we're thinking about building a new type of water heater on a piece of land we already own, we can't sell that land to somebody else. And we'll look for externalities. If we're building a new water heater, some of the sales of that new water heater are cannibalizing sales of our existing line of water heaters. Here's an example of a capital budgeting problem. GPC is considering a new project, which is the application of a new liquid nano coating technology to a new type of solar water heater. They've got a 3-year license from a local university, after which the license is open to all companies. So let's talk about how much risk there is. It's not clear how well the water heater will work. It's not clear how strong the demand for it will be. It's not clear how long it will be before the product becomes obsolete, or how competition will affect cash flows after the license is open to all. Still, the water heater has potential for being profitable, though it could fail miserably. And GPC is a relatively large company, and this would just be one of many products, so failure would not bankrupt the firm, but it would hurt profits. So what we're going to do is we're going to try to make an estimate of the money we have to spend at time zero to get this project going, and then the cash inflows over, say, the next 4 years. Then we'll find the present value of those future cash flows at our weighted average cost of capital, subtract from that our initial investment, and if we have a positive net present value, the project is a go. There are lots of ways to go about this. You could be as casual as guessing it's going to cost us about $10 million to build the equipment, and we'll get about $3 million a year in incremental cash flows. But capital budgeting has serious consequences for a company. It's big amounts of money that are going to be out there invested for long periods of time. A capital budgeting mistake is a very costly one. So instead, we're probably going to be very careful and make very precise guesses at all the aspects of this project. For example, we might start by estimating that the cost to build the equipment to make these new water heaters is going to cost us $10 million. So let's do everything in thousands. So this number looks like 10,000, but it really means 10 million. We estimate that after we run this thing for 4 years, we can sell the equipment for $1 million. There's no opportunity cost. It's not like we own this land before, and if we build these water heaters there, we can't sell it for something else. There's no externalities, cannibalization of existing sales. Let's talk about a quick example of that. For example, if a grocery chain has an existing store in a city or a town, and they're thinking about adding a second store, when they're looking at those cash flows for the second store, their cash flow estimations have to take into account the fact that some of those stores' sales in that new store are cannibalizing existing stores. So we want to look, when we're trying to do capital budgeting projects, at incremental cash flows, new cash flows. Then we predict that we're going to sell 10,000 units the first year. Second year, we're going to sell 20% more than the first year. The third year, we're going to sell 20% more than the first year. And then our license runs out. And so when we get to year four, our sales are going to drop by 30%. We also estimate that our sales price per unit is $2,000, that our price is going to go up by 4%. Since inflation is built into our cost of capital, remember there's an inflation premium built into the cost of our debt, we should include inflation in our projected cash flows. So here we're projecting our sales price will go up by 4%. Our variable costs per unit are $1,560, and we expect them to go up 3% a year. Our fixed costs are $1,107,000, and we expect them to go up 3% a year. This company has a weighted average cost of capital of 9%. The money costs them 9% on the right-hand side of the balance sheet. their investors have a required return of 9%. But since this project is riskier than the normal project, we're going to use a 10% discount rate. This is called a risk-adjusted discount rate. If a project is riskier than normal, we use a higher rate. And if it's less risky, we may use a lower rate. And the working capital as a percent of next year's sales, in other words, we've got to buy some inventory to build the water heaters we're going to sell the next year. We estimate that to be 10% of the following year's sales. All right, let's plug those assumptions into our model and see what kind of base case we get. If we sell 10,000 units at $2,000 a unit, our sales will be $20 million. Our variable cost per unit times the number of units gives us $15,600,000 minus our fixed costs, but we separate out depreciation. Depreciation is a non-cash expense. We can't ignore it because it reduces our income taxes, but it is not a cash expense. So this first year, we predict that with a depreciation of $3,333,000, that we're actually going to lose money. But that's not necessarily bad news. That's going to provide us a tax deduction for our other operations. Well, where did we get that depreciation number? We got it from the Modified Accelerated Cost Recovery System. Remember that awful chapter in financial accounting where we talked about straight-line depreciation and 150% of declining balance and 200% of declining balance and some of the year's digits and service units, etc. to calculate depreciation expense. Well, the federal government got tired about 40 years ago looking at all the different tax returns with all those different ways of depreciating assets, and they came up with the Modified Accelerated Cost Recovery System, where they just tell us the percentages. So what we're going to do is we're going to use this column here for our equipment, and that's the depreciation we'll book. There's also something called bonus depreciation. Congress always wants to encourage businesses to buy new equipment, so they let them take a lot of depreciation up front. That makes the net present value look better because that depreciation is a non-cash expense, but reduces the cash expense of income taxes. All right, so our NOPAT, our net operating profit after taxes, is this minus 30, which is $30,000, by the way. But what we're going to do is we're going to add back the depreciation expense. It's a non-cash expense, and we're looking at net cash flows. We're also going to subtract $496. What that is we had $2 million of money we invested in inventory to build the first year's water heaters. We have to invest $2,496,000 to build years two, but we got that $2 million back when we sold the units in year one. So net our inventory, we have to spend minus $496 to replenish our inventory. And so when you do that, you end up with a positive cash flow of $2,807. You do the same thing for years two, three, and four with the sales increases and the cost increases we predicted, and you end up with minus $12 million at time zero, plus $2,807,000, plus $4,415,000, plus $5,084,000, and plus $4,464,000. Keep in mind in that last year, we also sold the equipment for $1 million, paid taxes at 25%, so that we have a positive cash flow of $750,000 in that last year. Excel will tell us that this project has a positive net present value of 1,070, but let's do that on our own in our financial calculator. So what we'll do is we'll go to the cash flow menu, we'll hit second, clear to clear everything out of the cash flow menu. We'll say that we have 12,000, again that's 12 million, but let's say it's $12,000 out at time zero. Hit enter, down, it wants to know the first cash flow, that's 2,807. Enter down. How many times do we get it? Once. Enter down. Second cash flow is 4,415 in. Enter down. How many years do we get that? Once. Enter down. The third year we get 5,084 in. Enter down. And then how many times do we get that? Once. enter down. And then finally, the last year, we get 4464, enter down, 1, enter down. And we want to find the NPV, and then it asks us the interest rate. We're going to use 10. Remember, this company usually has a weighted average cost of capital of 9, but since this is a risky project, we're using a risk-adjusted rate that's a little bit higher. So we'll hit enter, and then down, and then we'll compute NPV. And sure enough, there's our 1069. Excel has 1070. So this project looks like a go. Now that we know the cash flow estimations, how risky is this project? There are theoretically three kinds of risks. The standalone risk is if this project were the only project in our company. The corporate risk, how does it fit in with our other assets? If we're an umbrella company and we buy a suntan lotion company, that kind of helps our risk. And then market risk at the stockholder level, how does this project help them with their own diversification? So all these are hard to evaluate, the last two more so than any other. So let's take a look at just the standalone risk. When I think about standalone risk, I think about the three S's. There's sensitivity, scenario, and simulation. What we do with sensitivity is we find three or four or five variables, three or four or five of the guesses we made, and we change them one at a time. And so that only one of them is changing. For example, if we're off by 30%, if our price that we can charge is 30% higher than what we estimated, then we've hit a home run. Our net present value goes from $1 million to $16,403,000. If it's bad news, if we have to charge 30% less, we're down here at the other end, then our net present value goes to a negative $14,264,000. And judging by the slopes of these lines, it looks like we're particularly sensitive to price and to the variable cost per unit. Another way to present exactly the same information is the tornado diagram. So here's our positive $16,403,000. Here's our negative $14,264,000. And we sort them so that the variables that have the highest sensitivity who will affect the net present value the most are listed at the top. So now we have an idea that this analysis is sensitive to price and to variable cost per unit. That's one perception of our risk, one aspect of our risk. Sensitivity, scenario, simulation. Let's talk about scenario now. We have a base case scenario. Let's create a worst case scenario and then maybe a best case scenario. And we could copy and paste this Excel worksheet into another worksheet inside the same workbook. We could create another workbook, or we can use this handy dandy tool called, under data, what if analysis, scenario manager. Let's add a new scenario. Let's call it worst case. We tell Excel which cells are going to change, and then we input the changes that we want. One of them is the name change, so that when we're looking at the screen, we can see which case is actually running. And let's say that the equipment costs us $11 million instead of $10 million. Let's say that our first year sales, instead of 10,000 units, we only sell 8,500 units. Let's say that our sales price isn't $2,000 a unit, but instead it's $1,800 per unit. Let's say that our sales increases aren't 4%, but 3%. Let's change our variable cost per unit to go from 1.56 to 1.72. So that's up a little bit. And let's say that those also go up by 4%. And since our variable costs are up, maybe we can say that our fixed costs are going to be down to 941. We'll click OK, and then we'll say, show us the worst case. And it's changed all the assumptions for us there. Close that up, and if we scroll down a little bit, we should see that the net present value has turned to negative on us. And sure enough, it's now a negative 9795. So we run three different scenarios. Maybe there's a 25% chance that the best case comes out, a 50% chance that the base case comes out, and a 25% that worst case comes out. That gives us an expected NPV of a positive $1,854,000. But there's a pretty big standard deviation. It's a standard deviation of $8,827,000. So 68% of the time, the outcome is going to be between a negative $7,757,000 and a positive $9,879,000. That sounds like a lot of risk to me. Okay, so we talked about sensitivity analysis, running three different scenarios. There's also simulation. So what we might do is we might take a range for some of the important variables, establish a range, and then use the random feature within Excel or Google Sheets to generate random scenarios with different combinations of those main factors and see what kind of net present value we get then. Well, if we've got a risky project, what do we do about it? Well, one thing we could do is we do decision tree analysis where we stage things so that we can quit early on if things start to go the bad direction. The other thing we can do, the textbooks love to talk about real options and they want to contrast those with stock options. So I buy a share of Apple stock and I'm worried that it's going to go down in price. What I can do is I can buy a put, so I have a right to sell that stock to somebody at a specific price 30, 60, 90 days from now. If it's an American option, I could sell it at any time. If it's a European option, I can only sell it on a certain date. But the point is, I have protected myself with that option. Textbooks love to talk about capital expenditure real options in the same breath. And those, in my mind, they're a different beast. But they are abandonment. We can quit the project. We could build the factory a little bit bigger than we need so that we can grow it and do something even better in the future. Or we can build the project with flexibility. Maybe we're building a car plant that builds gas-powered automobiles, but we set it up so that it can easily be changed over to electric vehicles.